Well, we welcome you to FCCW and know that you are always welcome here, no matter where you are on your life's journey. Just a couple announcements that I want to make this morning. There's in your bulletin, there's a lot of announcements, and you'll learn a lot more in detail, but just want to highlight a couple. There's a dinner theater night planned by the Family Care Board. So some of you might remember that we did this last year. And what did we see? Fiddler on the Roof. Yes, it was a lot of fun. Go to take the jolly, the trolley from the Kingswood Arts Center, go to Birch and Vine in Melvin Village, and then have a nice dinner there, and then make your way to Meredith at Interlakes, where you'll be seeing Legally Blonde. So, which is a great show. I just saw it in Prescott Park. So if you are interested in that, please see Barbara. She has sign-ups. You could always call Kathy Fairman. Her phone number is in the bulletin. There will be, Pastor Dawn is going to be working on a behavioral covenant, and she would like us all to work together on that. So on the Sunday mornings, the 11th and the 18th, between 8:30 to 9:30 in the morning, breakfast will be served, so please come, and in Fellowship Hall, and so she'll be offering a workshop then. There's also another announcement about Accessible to All. As many of you know, or some of you might know, that we are working on becoming accessible to all people here, which means so many different things about being inclusive. So if you would like to be part of this committee to find out and learn more how our church can be more welcoming, then please see Connie Turner, who's in the back. She's looking for some people to work with her. This past Friday, we weren't able to have our gathering for motherless daughters because Helen had elbow surgery and wrist surgery. She broke her wrist, she broke her elbow. So she will be offering that again on August 16th. But we offer her our prayers for recovery. So I think that's all I have for now. Is there anything else that I forgot? Nope. Okay, thank you.
And so as we gather ourselves in, let us let our mind catch up with our body. Let us unhook from the chronos of time and place ourselves in kairos, God's time. I want you to try a settling technique that my grandson Aiden taught me. Hold one hand with your finger splayed. Use your pointer finger from the other hand to run an outline of your hand starting at your outer wrist. So up and down your fingers like this will progress. But as you go up your finger, take a deep breath in, and as you go down, breathe out. And up your pointer finger, and down. And keep going across your hand. And as you make it to your pinky, don't stop there, but reverse it. Don't forget to breathe in and out. Let that ground you and hold you as we listen to the prelude. Let yourself just be before God as you are.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able in body or spirit and join me in today's call to worship as printed in your bulletin. We are witnesses. We are witnesses. We are witnesses. Surprised, challenged, healed, and nourished. We gather together to worship. Let us pray. Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit, meet us in this place. Comfort us, convict us, inspire us, dance with us. Let us together share this time that we return refueled and rejuvenated to do the work that you call us to. Amen. Let us sing together, Enter, Rejoice, and Come in the Black Hymnal number 73. And having fully arrived, I invite you to turn to your neighbor and say hello and greet them with peace as the kids might come over for the chancel steps. Sophia, have a seat. I got some stuff for us. Yeah. We have some other kids. I saw them. You can come up with them if they want to come. Don't feel pressured. Oh. Come on up, guys. Parents are welcome, too. It's an all ages thing. What? I heard a what? Adult, if you don't have kids with you, you can come up, too. I know, people are like, what? That's what Krista said when she saw this stuff next to me. She was like, what do you got going on? Well, thank you, Connie. Connie came up. So I brought some items with me today, some very different items. And I'm wondering, when you look at them, what do you notice? What do you think about them? What do you think?
All tools.
I think that's true. They can definitely be used as tools. Anyone else have some observations about these things?
They look fun.
Oh, yeah. We could build some really interesting things, couldn't we?
Yeah.
And we really could. Does anyone notice anything else? I don't know if you adults can see it. I have a Cuisinart measuring cup, a hose, a colander, a basket, a different kind of basket, like for vegetables, and an open-ended extrusion. Honestly, this was in the garage. I have no idea. But do you notice some similarities about these things?
Three have holes in them and three don't.
Ooh, you're right on the right track. Say more. What do you mean they have holes?
Like those Go ahead. Have like tiny holes and these have like big kind of holes.
Yeah, right. So like the colander has tiny holes and the basket has tiny holes. Might that be because they're meant to do something different? What do you think this might be for? Anyone have an idea? For straining. That's right. That's right. This has holes too, but is it meant to strain, do you think?
No.
No, what do you think this is for?
Hold food.
Hold food, yes. Or my coasters on my coffee table, whichever, exactly. How about this? This has holes. Is it meant to strain? No, what do you think it's for? When might you use it?
Gathering vegetables.
This is my market basket, exactly. And notice, though, that these all have bottoms, right? Like you're not supposed to be able to go through them. If you do, we have a problem. But this one and this one don't have bottoms. What good are they? What might we use that or this for? Any ideas? And you can't be wrong, because I don't really know where that came from. So what do you think? Do you have a thought? Okay, adults, we need your help. What might we use this for? Oh, plumbing, yes. So what goes through it if it's plumbing?
Water.
Water. It's a hose, right? Now, this is what we call an extrusion, possibly an extruded aluminum piece. Any ideas? I have a guess of what it is, but does anyone know what it's for?
Maybe it's for, like, a building that you're trying to build?
Yes, I would bet it's for the dock out front, and I would bet that there's a pipe that goes in here and a pipe that goes in here, and that it holds it together just like Legos or something, a modern form of Legos. And the reason I bring all these shapes to you is because we might want to think about what shape we are. I know that sounds funny because you probably think, this is my shape, I'm a human being. But when we receive God into us, what shape might we make to hold on? Do we even, you think a circle?
Yeah.
Yeah. Make the circle wide, right? We sing that? I think a circle is a good observation. And do we even want to contain it? Or do we want to crack the bottom off and let God flow through? That is the song that we're going to sing in a minute. But I want you all to think of what shape you want to be so that you can receive God within you. Okay? Let's offer a prayer. Would you fold your hands? Holy God of many shapes and sizes and sorts, help us to be the receptacle into which you pour your love. Let us not just desire to contain it, but instead shear the end off and be a conduit for your love out into a wider world. May you and may we make it so. Amen. And so we're going to sing this song that is on the back of your bulletins, and it's called Empty Jar. And it might take us more than once to get it, but let's sing it once through and then maybe again. Try it one more time, Andy. May it be so. May we make ourselves conduits of God's love into the world. You guys can go back to your seats. Thank you for your help today. Let us open our heart and pray. The Spirit of the Lord has spoken, and this is what God asks of us: to act justly, to love tenderly, and to walk humbly. Let us consider where we have done this well this week. And where we may do better next week. For our failure to act justly, for our community's failure to love tenderly, for our society's failure to walk humbly. God's love is extravagant. God's grace is unending. Know that you are forgiven, loved, and beloved. May you live into the blessing of that gracious love. Let us prepare our hearts and mind to hear the word. Would you pray with me? God, we often think of you as sitting on high, and then believe that we too are due such honor. Wake us up to this provocative word as offered by your Son, and remind us of the benefits of humility and generosity. Amen.
Many of us remember the hosting rules of Emily Post. Some may identify more with the entertaining rules of Martha Stewart. Not too many of us think of Jesus as the person to lean on when planning or attending a party. Interestingly, he does have some advice. May we open ourselves to hearing this reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14, verses 7 through 14. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who has invited both of you may come and say to you, "Give this person your place," and then in disgrace you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes in, he may say to you, "Friend, move up higher." Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers and sisters or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Here ends our scripture. May God add to our understanding.
Thanks be to God. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Do you remember the song, "My Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean, My Bonnie Lies Over the Sea"? I see heads shaking. Some of you remember this. Now, when you sing this song, some of you remember and some of you don't, that you are meant to sit and stand with each bee. So feel free to join in voice or in action as we attempt one verse. Ready? Okay, I mean, get those thighs ready. This is a thigh burner. My Bonnie lies over the ocean. My Bonnie lies over the sea. My Bonnie lies over the ocean. Bring back my Bonnie to me. Bring back, my Bonnie to me. Bring back my Bonnie to me. If you recall, each round goes a little faster, and I'll spare us the challenge. And usually the whole thing deteriorates into laughter because eventually you are unsure if you are standing or sitting. And frankly, it seemed that we forgot what the letter B was because we were sitting and standing on words like ocean and sea and me. This childhood camp song popped into my head as I read and was looking over our scripture for today. Do we sit low or do we sit high? Do we get moved closer to the seat of honor or farther away? Do we invite only those who will return the invitation for us? Or do we truly serve and invite those who have no way to repay us? Up, down, up, down, down, up. Even if you back up our reading to the beginning of chapter 14, you see the movement oscillating between up and down and down and up. Jesus is invited into the house of the leader of the Pharisees, i.e. his stature is lifted up. But it says that they were not inviting him for a good time, or because they wanted to hear him preach, or because he was a good guy, or because he needed a meal. Instead, they raised him up so that they could watch him more closely and catch him if he misstepped, at which time they would bring him low. Up, down, down, up, down, up. And then the story continues as the group walks to dinner and they come by a man who was low. He was suffering from what we believe was a form of edema, referred to as dropsy in the scripture. Jesus wanted to lift him up and heal him on the spot. But the Pharisees, due to the religious restriction of healing on the Sabbath, wanted to maintain the status quo, at least for a few more hours, even if that meant leaving the man down. To which Jesus tells the tale of bringing up the oxen from the well. Who amongst you, if your oxen fell in a well on the Sabbath, would not pull it out? Up, down, down, up, up, down. Jesus was not here to maintain equilibrium. His job was not to maintain the status quo. He was not beholden to the empires of this earth or to the people who thought themselves powerful. He was here for purpose. His work was not to be delayed. He was here to shake things up, to remind us that things didn't have to be the way they were. He was here to capsize expectations and radically reverse power structures. He was here to show that God, the greatest of all, could enter our reality in the form of a vulnerable baby. A king could be born a pauper in a backwater to an unwed mother. Jesus came, as it is said, to afflict the comfortable and to comfort the afflicted. Down, up, up, down, down, up. These reversals became even more evident when you think of the parables Jesus told at this banquet. They become almost farcical when you think, who is telling them? Is he talking about what is happening in the now, the dinner that he is sitting at that moment? Or is he alluding to the hereafter and the great banquet in the by and by? Or the world that God imagines we might all live in? We don't know where the Pharisees sat Jesus as Jesus spoke about the proper seating etiquette. We are not offered a seating chart. We do know, though, that whether this Pharisee or the other guests acknowledged it or not, Jesus is and would have been the most important guest at that banquet. Thus, he should have been the one lifted up to the seat of honor. In fact, if you look back to Proverbs 25, 6 through 7, you would hear, and those present at the banquet would know and recognize Jesus' reference when he spoke, that Scripture says, "Do not put yourself forward in the king's presence or stand in the place of the great, for it is better to be told, 'Come up here,' than to be put lower in the presence of a noble." Jesus, in his retelling, never says the word king, nor directly implies the connotation, but we sure get the irony. Unfortunately, we take our faith and Scripture too seriously to see the humor embedded in it. I suspect and can imagine Jesus likely told that story having been seated far away from the head of the table, having been jockeyed out of position by the others in attendance, who hubristically seated themselves closer to the head of the table. And I suspect that when Jesus made note of the host coming and reordering the seating arrangement, he was not referring to the Pharisee who was hosting the dinner party that night. I do not expect that his seating on that night was changed at all. I suspect that Jesus was talking about the eschatological great banquet that we are all invited to in the hereafter, which is hosted by God, God's self, in the place where we know Jesus is lifted up. In essence, Jesus is saying, "You can put me as low as you want, because the real host will make it right later. Down, up, up, down, up." The story continues. As Jesus looks around some more, he gets a little snarkier when he observes that those invited to this dinner aren't here because they need dinner. They've all been invited for purposes of assuring connection, privilege, and perhaps some future payback. So he offers a glimpse of the true kingdom banquet, where roles are reversed and the poor are lifted up and the meek inherit the earth and the merciful are shown mercy and where people don't hunger for food anymore but are filled with righteousness. See, we have a tendency to try to tame our Scripture. But Scripture is not meant to be tamed. It is radical, it is revolutionary, it is countercultural. It should really come with a warning label. As it was once said by Annie Dillard in her book, Teaching a Stone to Talk, we should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. Scripture is not a tame cat, but a lioness protecting her cubs. Theologian Carolyn Sharp writes in her commentary on this text on the Working Preacher website, "Jesus invites hearers to imagine a transformative web of relations woven in mercy and strengthened not through patronage or obligation, but through joyous connection across lines of difference." Jesus says, "No up, no down, no crazy games of trying to place ourselves in a tower of power or privilege or doing good because one day we believe we're going to cash in. Instead, we are to weave into one another, creating a tapestry of life, creating a web of care and concern, complementing and supplementing one another as needed, connecting to and with each other, and holding one another. We are to be a blessing to one another, to give blessings and to receive blessings, never keeping score, being both generous and gracious. Jesus is again imagining a world where the last shall be first and the first shall be last, imagining in a way that most of us fail because we have been acculturated to think so linearly and have been so well trained to be dutiful, but to which I was offered a sacred view of what might be possible when a Sunday school class sought to show a way that the last could be first and the first could be last without a single person being left behind, and honestly, not anyone being first or last. Can you imagine it? The third graders intertwined their arms, one next to the other, and they walked forward. No one first, no one last. It was a humbling sight and mind-blowing, rethinking of what might be possible. They could, through their innocence, imagine a world where we could be one cohesive, complementary community, no longer caught up by privilege or power or position, where we each look to each other as necessary parts of the whole, and where we worried about where each other was, waiting, holding, carrying each other across the finish line. Jesus says to us, do not look to those who can benefit you, but to those who can benefit from you. As I close, I want to offer you this from a Facebook meme that I saw this Friday, which was attributed to a person named Dan Sadlier. It goes like this: Christianity can be confusing, but the way of Jesus, well, that's pretty clear. Move toward the poor. Empower women. Create space at the table. Throw parties. Widen family boundaries. Poke holes in oppressive systems. Don't retaliate with violence. Forgive your enemy. Don't store up wealth. Be present with people. Heal. Announce. Push back the darkness. The kingdom of God is near. This is our call as children of God. May we each dare to make it so. Amen. And with that in our mind and in our heart, I invite you to stand and sing and feel and believe this song. For everyone born, a place at the table. The words are in your bulletin.
Thank you.
You may be seated. As it has become our custom, as I offer this pastoral prayer, I will lift up my arms, and if you have a name that you want to lift up to God, please say it one atop another. Let us be together in prayer. Holy One, as we think of your welcome table, we think of those who do not consider themselves worthy to sit at it. We pray for a world where all people know their inherent worth. We think of those who believe themselves entitled and who assume the best seat at the table is theirs. We pray for a world where humility is seen as a blessing, and those who have financial advantage or the power of privilege or prestige always seek to lift others up and see value in more than just bank accounts or initials after a name. We think of those who do unto others only in response to what has or might be done unto them. We pray for a world where right is right and generosity is the norm. We pray for all those Jesus named who are often forgotten at our dinner tables, those who are impoverished, those who are hungry, those who may be shunned from society or without a washing machine to clean their clothes or a shower to clean themselves. We pray for those who may be labeled as different because of physical or cognitive challenges or an accident that has occurred. We pray for those who are most marginalized and might be afraid to enter such a banquet hall, let alone ever dare to take a seat. We pray for the least, the lost, and the lonely, and for every person who has ever felt the sting of being an outcast. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray too today for many who are on our heart, trusting that as we lift their names one atop another, that you will know their need. Hear now those we know to need your care and healing. We pray also for those we have forgotten to name, we do not know how to name, or we do not even know to name. In this moment of silence, search our hearts. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Sharing isn't always a physical thing like a coat or a cookie or a coin. Sometimes it's about making room, inviting in, welcoming. As we gather today's tithes and offerings, consider how you are going to commit to invite someone to the proverbial table. How will you make room for another and make sure that they get what they need? How can you lift someone up this week? Today's tithes and offerings will now be received.
Give me love, give me love, give me peace on earth. Give me life, keep me free from birth. Give me hope, help me cope with this heavy load. Trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Give me life, keep me free from birth. Give me hope, help me cope with this heavy load. Trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Keep me free from birth. Give me hope, help me cope with this heavy load. Trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Give me peace on earth. Give me life, keep me free from birth now. Give me hope, help me cope with this heavy loads, trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Oh.
Let us pray. Gracious God, receive our commitments of action and coin. We trust in you and we seek to walk in your way. Let this exercise in giving, releasing, and doing with a little less teach us to be better disciples out in the world. Use what we have given and committed to make this world a better place. Amen. Let us sing together again the song in your bulletin, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Amen.
We go in hope. We go in wonder. We go in joy. We go in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so we're going to try something a little challenging today. We'll see how it goes. It went very well at Kate Park, not to set the bar too high. So you know this song. We have sung it so many times, right? We have sung it over and over. And so we're going to start here, and we're going to sing two parts. And then we're going to go here, and you guys are going to start. And then guess what happens? You guys are small, but you are mighty. See, Rayanne knows, mighty. And I'm still flipping to make sure I have the right words because it's in my brain and it'll disappear like the wind. So, are you ready for it? Let's sing it once all together, and then we're all going to stop, and you're going to start, then you're going to start, and I'm going to stick with you, okay? And God willing, we're going to keep going three times. To me, this is the benediction because it tells us what is possible when good people work together for a good cause. May we sing. Let's sing it together.
Now in peace, oh, now in peace, may the love of God surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go.
Ready?
Go now in peace.
Us that world peace is possible. If we can sing it around, it's possible when we work together, when we listen to one another, when we imagine what is possible and seek together to make it work. So go so filled with that possibility that it can't help but come together with the help of God. May God fill you, may God protect you, may God walk with you today and always. Amen.